Good morning, everybody. So yes, I'd like to formally welcome you on behalf of Culture Bridge North East. It's really nice to see you all here today. This is part of our Let's Play programme, and it's called, the session today is called Music Moves with Kate. I'm Charlotte and I'm CPD manager here at Culture Bridge North East, so I lead on all of our fantastic CPD for teachers and practitioners and cultural organisations across the region, and like Kate says, internationally at the moment, which is brilliant. So Culture Bridge North East is Art Council England's bridge organisation for the North East. And what we do is connect the cultural and the education sectors together so that children and young people have access to a really rich cultural education. So now I'd like to introduce and hand over to Kate, who is our early years foundation stage consultant here at Culture Bridge. And Kate's been with us for a couple of years now, leading on our Let's Play program, which is fantastic. And we've got a plethora of brilliant speakers too. I think this is the most speakers we've had at a Let's Play session, so I'm really excited. We've got Dr. Jessica Pitt. You can give us a wave, Jess. There she is. Head teacher John Croft, but he's joining us from the past on a pre-record, but he will be here. We've got early years practitioners Annie Horsburgh and Libby Hepwell. Hi, we've got Leslie Forrester, speech and language therapist, and her dog and hens, I believe. Gwyneth Lamb, external evaluator, and Zoe Kiln from Youth Music. So without further ado, I'm going to hand back over to Kate now, and I hope you have a really brilliant morning.
Thank you, Charlotte. That's absolutely fabulous. Well, just again, hello and welcome to our Music Moves sharing event. I just want to say a really big thank you to you all for being here, because it's a really big commitment. So thank you for giving us your time. And also, there's some people who have been to, like, not one, not two, not three, but four, or maybe even all of our events. So it is lovely to see some of the same faces again and again and again. And we really hope we might be getting something right then by you coming back again and again and again. So thank you so much. So yes, a little intro to this event. So I'm Kate, and I've been working in the field of early years music for about 20 years, but I really don't want to make this about me, so I'm going to keep that bit really short. The project that we're going to share with you today is the work that I've been leading in North Tyneside, which is where I live, and it's called Music Moves, because for me, those two elements are the key in every single project I ever do, is that it's music moving us emotionally, but also the music and movement, because all of the children need to move, so it's about meeting that need for them to move. So Music Moves is a project that, in its inception, it was May, I think, 2021, that I first picked up the phone and called, I think, a few people. I called Gwyneth, I called Leslie, I called John Croft, who are people I'd worked with. I'd had a career break for about 6 years, so I was coming back. I made a few phone calls and said, I think I'm quite interested in maybe working with two-year-olds. I think I'm interested in working with COVID babies. What do you think? That's where it started. And then we put in an application to Youth Music, and the project kicked off in January of 2022. And then I was in the setting from January to July. And as you can see, we're still in the dissemination phase of it now. We worked with two-year-olds and their families and their carers and their practitioners. And we were based in Sir James Knott Nursery School, which is the only nursery school in North Tyneside. So its status is a school rather than a nursery. So that is an interesting and slightly different setup. I'm just going to introduce the team, because I'm one of many on this project. So I'm the project manager and the lead practitioner, but work as part of a team. So I'm going to introduce Leslie. Can you say hi, Leslie?
Can. Hello, everyone. Hope you can hear me.
So this is Leslie Forrester, who's one of my team. Leslie Forrester is a speech and language therapist, and actually the head of early years in North Tyneside told me she was the best she'd ever met the other week. So lucky me. She uses music in all of her work and has recently set herself up as an animal assisted person with her own company, and you will see coming in and out of shot. Is it Heidi you've got with you today?
Gunther, actually. That Gunther. Was Gunther. Heidi is here. Heidi is hanging out here with Gunther somewhere. I don't know if you can see her there.
She's, yeah. So that's the beautiful Heidi. And Heidi is the dog who has come to work alongside Leslie to do animal assisted work with 2-year-olds and the families. It's a new area of delivery for me, and it's been really magical. So Leslie will talk to us a little bit about that. Also here today, we have got Dr. Jessica Pitt. Do you want to say hi?
Morning, everyone. Yeah.
And I involved Jess because I'm interested in action research. And I didn't even really know what that was or what it meant, and I'm still learning. So Jess works alongside me to help me and the team work out what sorts of action research we can undertake within these music projects and what sorts of things we could be exploring. So Jessica's going to share some of those findings with us. And also we've got Gwyneth. Do you want to say hi, Gwyneth?
Hello.
Hi, I've worked with Gwyneth since I first ever was making my first youth music application. She's been a huge supporter and advocate, and was once Northeast, you were once the Northeast, were you like the Northeast kind of boss person for youth music? That's not the official title, is it? But so Gwyneth was the regional person for youth music up in the Northeast, which is how I first met her. And then over the years, Gwyneth has supported me with monitoring and evaluation. And actually in Music Moves, that role shifted a bit, because I needed a mentor, and Gwyneth is brilliant at that. So Gwyneth has kind of become over time mentor and critical friend. And again, I'd recommend anybody undertaking these sorts of projects to consider your wider team, your wider needs. So it's not just you if you're a practitioner. So you've got mentor support, I've got action research support. And obviously with Leslie, not only have I got animal assisted, I've got a speech and language therapist, which at the moment everybody is crying out for. And possibly most importantly of all, Annie and Libby, who've disappeared off my screen. So hang on, let me go. I think they're on another screen. Annie and Libby, do you want to say hi?
Hi, everyone.
There you are. So Annie and Libby are the ones with the 2-year-olds and Sir James Knott every single day. This is incredible. I mean, really, I just hats off. They're in, obviously, everybody in a nursery it knows this, but sometimes as a music practitioner, I think you've got to remind yourself the reality on the ground, which is that the people who are working with the kids are in from like 8 till whatever time, and you know, with tiny breaks, and they're go, 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 meeting 2-year-olds' needs all the time, every day. And they really care about the children, they really love the children, and they really embrace the project. And I really wanted them here today because, in a way, it's the most important voice. They're the ones who are with the kids every single day, and they're the ones making sure the project has a legacy. And without them, I couldn't have done the work, because they know the children so, so, so very well that actually we had to work alongside each other to make sure that what I was doing met the children's needs. And the learning exchange between me and those early years practitioners was really, really quite magical. So I think... yeah, I think that's probably enough of an introduction. What I was going to just ask us to have a little think about to start with was, I asked you to do a little task ahead of the event. Now, if you've not even seen this task and you don't know what I'm going on about, that is completely fine. Don't worry about it. I'm going to share my screen now so you can see what the task was. If you did get a chance to scribble down the task, grab it, even if it means you've got to leave the room or something, grab wherever you wrote it down and then pop it into the chat. And I'm just going to do a screen share so that those who might not have seen it know what that task is. And then we'll all get thinking about engagement. So I'm going to share my screen. So I work with 2-year-olds. So I just want you to have a think. How have you seen and heard 2-year-olds engaging in music? You could focus on one particular child you're the key worker for. Consider your own child or family member, or consider this in a wider group context. There are no right or wrong answers. Type into chat. So just have a little think. So it's just to get us thinking about musical engagement. What does it look like? What does it sound like? Drumming on upturned metal pans with wooden spoons. Lovely. Dancing, wiggling. Yeah, wiggling. That's a really big one with 2-year-olds. Musical instruments in the environment. Absolutely. Pots and pans. Quiet, focused. Oops, that went, hang on. Quiet, focused exploration, sitting on the floor, completely immersed. Yes, that sort of engagement fascinates me. That's the immersion. Yeah, absolutely, Barbara. Dancing during group times, action songs, etc. Smiling. Yay. Wiggling, jiggling, vocalizing, sometimes listening. Uh-huh. Yes, yeah, sometimes listening. That's absolutely true of 2-year-olds. singing fragments. I like it. Singing fragments, Becky, absolutely. Bouncing on knees as soon as accordion plays. Lovely. Jumping, dancing, musical instruments, music, playing, body percussion, nursery rhymes. Oh, someone from their own children. That's lovely. They used to like, I used to go to rhyme time. My children, when they were small, they used to like singing and dancing to the TV radio too. Yeah. Often back of the cars, actually. Often back of the car is where I hear about lots of favourite things is in the back of the car. Brilliant. Okay, fantastic. Great. All right, thank you. I think we will move on because Charlotte has prompted me that I need to crack on. But thank you so much because I think it's really good to get us just to start to think about engagement and what you have seen and heard in terms of that engagement. So let's have a look. Okay, great. At this point, you see, we could almost do a day or a week seminar. So basically, we're going to do our best to give you a flavour of this Music Moves project, which really is an 18-month project that went to a lot of depth. I want to give you a taste of it, I want to give you a flavour, and I want to inspire your own practice. If there's anybody here today who is wanting, like, well, everybody likes a takeaway, you're thinking, I'd like some songs, I'd like some ideas, and like some resources. They're all on my website. So if you're going through the day and you think, oh shit, I haven't got any songs, there's loads on my website, and Abby's going to put a link in the chat for you. So if you need songs in a particular area, I've got MP3s, I've got PDFs, I've got song sheets. So I've kind of got you covered. But today is not really about repertoire. It's about practice, and it's about what engagement looks like. And it's about what we found to be the most effective and engaging ways to work with two-year-olds. So that said, I am now going to hand over to Dr. Jessica Pitt to talk us through the action research element of the project.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be here. Great to see lovely faces on the gallery view. So, yeah, as Kate has said so eloquently, we are looking at engagement in music, and we use that word, and we assume, of course, that it means the same thing to everyone. So we're just going to unpick that a little bit through these slides. We decided to use action research because we were really wanting to investigate and think about practice, and I'm sure all of us are doing this in our work anyway. We're planning, doing, and reviewing. It's a natural process of our work. But we had a specific sort of catch in and a check in opportunity every so often for reflection. So how we came to this question was through a familiarization phase. And I'll talk about that in a sec. So we had a focus question. And I think that's just something perhaps to think about. What is it that you'd like to look at in your practice, and just to frame it as a question, and then to go through a process of maybe collecting some data or reflecting in a journal, and then to discuss together, think about next steps, and can do the cycle again. And that can be a really useful way of just looking specifically with a laser view, if you like, on a question in practice. And that's really what we did. So, how did we land on this topic of engagement? Well, in the familiarization phase, Kate sent us her reflective journal. She's wonderful at writing loads and loads, copious notes about her practice. And what struck me was there was this word engaged. The children were really engaged. There was lots of engagement. And we met and reflected together. And I said, well, What does this look like, Kate? What does engagement look like? You're using this word, but actually, what are you seeing? And so we were striving to really get deeper into what this word can mean when one's observing practice, because we use words, but we sometimes need to really unpick them in order to get to the heart of things. And that's really what we were trying to do. And then we were just thinking about, well, okay, so now what have we learned for practice from looking in a detailed way at what engagement in music can look like? So these were some of the things that we saw or Kate saw. There was vocalizing, smiling, rhythmical activity, quite obvious things perhaps. But also we've got being involved in a different task yet still focused. And these are the things that maybe might be, they're a little bit more nuanced, and you may not necessarily think that's engagement, but actually children can be engaging in music in quite a range of ways. We had singing, we had rhythmic movement, and we had swaying. Now, Kate, I know that you've got some fantastic examples of some of these words that I've put in bold, and I just wonder if you want to come in and maybe give us a practical example, because they weren't necessarily what you'd expect.
Yeah, thank you, Jess. Yes, absolutely. Yeah, so one example was there was one little boy who I'm going to call Child A, who I'm going to tell you a little bit about in my little presentation. But this was an individual with additional needs who could be quite distressed, and it was a struggle for him to settle. The length of the morning was difficult. He was struggling with lots of fevers and things, as a lot of them were, because it was post-COVID times. And his response to the Hello song was really fascinating. And because I had my lens on and I was really looking at what engagement was, I noticed that what he did when I sang the Hello song, and it's just, you know, just goes like, hello, everyone, how are you? How are you today? But I would sing his name. And over time, I noticed that he would go to the same piece of furniture. We would go like into a little breakaway space. He would go to the same piece of furniture. He'd had his back to me. He would hold on to the furniture and he would move rhythmically from one foot to the other like this and like this. And he had his back to me, but I was told by the practitioners again, so the importance of the practitioner's role, the early years practitioner, that he was smiling. And that was just a real moment for me of like, wow, that's not necessarily obvious engagement if you're not looking for it, because I was in a different part of the room. I was singing the Hello song with a group of children who were sitting, maybe it's with more obvious engagement, and they were maybe joining in the song, they were maybe doing the Makaton, but there was Child A over in another bit of the room, holding on foot to foot, foot to foot. And I was really interested because every time I sang the song from that point onwards, he would choose to do that same thing.
Thanks, Kate. Yeah, so there are some other items on this list, such as being comfortable with attention, watching with interest. These are really clear indicators of engagement that might not be very obvious. They're not clearly sitting and joining in with things, but they are subtle indicators that children are engaging in activities. And you have to sort of have a nuanced look in order to spot all these perhaps more subtle pre-engagement, if you like, behaviours. I hate to use that word, but indicators, I suppose. And something to say, if I just go back a little bit to the action research cycle, what was really useful is that we could, when we met together in the reflection part of this cycle, we could do something which I loved the word that Mercer calls interthinking, where, you know, together you can get together and talk and reach an understanding that you wouldn't necessarily have achieved on your own, a little bit like Vygotsky and the way that peers kind of are able to do more than they can alone. And I think this interthinking element, the reflection side of talking about what you've seen and to kind of really unpick and get into the meat of it through diverse voices, can really help go further on in understanding practice, and particularly understanding non-verbal actions and activity. So there were some things that we found out about music that are really interesting to me. So 2-year-olds in the music room, music was serving quite a range of different purposes. There was music as an aesthetic art object, music to listen to. And music is wonderful in the fact that it can have meaning for both the performer and the listener. And we don't have to tell people what it means. It means what it means to them. And that can be a really useful thing. So it was music as an aesthetic art object. Children enjoyed being soothed and calmed and excited. Then there was music that had the function of a social activity around the scrunchie, around the gathering drum with the djembe in this wonderful picture. But music also was part of object play. And this is something that we see a lot in setting. Children engaging with loose parts, with objects in a musical way. They will also bring these toys onto musical instruments, putting the toys on the gathering drum, playing with puppets, egg shakers, using those as additional sound makers. Then we saw music as movement. There was jumping, there was the swaying, there was rolling on and off the gathering drum. And then there was music that was helping to make connections to other things. So it was the way that the silk cloth on the drum and the peekaboo and the forward roll and the spider puppet for Incy Wincy. There was a ribbit when seeing the frog Wiro and using a TikTok as a trumpet. And Froebel talks about the way that children make sense of the world through combining unrelated things. And we saw that quite a lot. So music's function in this two-year-old room was quite complex and dynamic. So what did we find about out for practice with children's musical play? Children are playing musically a lot of the time. We often have our goggles on to look for certain things, and that's absolutely right. But sometimes it might be worth, Nicola Burke talks about the goggles, to put your music goggles on and only look for indications of musicality. Just try it, because I think you will find that there is musical play going on all the time, in movement, in gesture, with objects, with the use of voices. There's rhythmic movement, there's rhythmic play. Children are learning by, as I said, making connections across and between unrelated things. So if you set up an environment, you might find that all those things end up somewhere else. And that's important, as you know, that's really important, that it's making connections. Objects and loose parts are really important in music play. It's helping that kind of bringing things into different worlds. This all takes time. And we need to give time for exploration, for movement. We need to give lots of time and space for this to happen. And there's been all this wonderful slow pedagogy, hasn't there, of Alison Clark? And I think we need to think about giving real time for exploration and music play. And children have loads of their own music play ideas that we can, if we've got our goggles on, pick up on and use as starting points to support and scaffold. They love being led by us. They love our adult directed music. They will love that, but they also love leading for themselves. And Kate's got some fabulous examples of children leading from the djembe. So in terms of findings for practice, I would say provide choice and time for children to explore sound materials in their own way. Plan an environment for music play with open-ended loose parts and sound makers and see what happens. Document it, record it, and have a cycle of reflection on it. Plan for moments where you lead as an adult, but also there's opportunities for children to lead. And if you can, in your planning, plan for children's musical ideas to be necessary, a necessary part of every adult-led activity. Include lots of repetition. Allow for children to watch with interest. They don't need to join in if they don't want to. They're still engaged if they're at the edge. And look for moments of intense flow where children are lost and caught up in the moment. That's a great signal. And use your knowledge of your children to document their focus. One size does not fit all. You know your children. You'll know what their energy and concentration in music looks like. And to practice observation, waiting and listening before you do anything will be a fantastic starting point. And as part of this, I've created a sort of simple card, which will be as part of the resources, which is the characteristics of effective music engagement, where all these things have kind of been summarized. So that is it from me. I am delighted to hand back to Kate.
Thank you, Jess. That's been really, really useful. If you've got any questions about that, you could stick them in the chat and make a little note of them, because I'm aware there might be burning questions. And just so you know, that we can stay on this call a little bit after. So if you have burning questions and they don't get answered. Thank you, Jess. That's just amazing, isn't it? And again, I think it's really enhanced the project to be working with Jess in this way, because it's really enabled me to go kind of quite deep down into my practice in a way that I just wouldn't have done if we hadn't had that time and space. And I think probably the most important thing I learned was the very last point on that last slide, which was observe, wait, listen, which I think of as owl, because it helps. If you picture an owl in your head, it really helps. So observe, wait, listen. It's become the most important part of my practice. That's why we had a familiarization stage at the beginning, where I was literally just in the setting. I wasn't delivering or leading anything. I was just getting to know everybody, and the children and the adults and the parents. 2-year-olds are so brilliant at engaging us as play partners. It's a challenge to observe, wait, listen. But I think having in your mind that that's what you want to do means that you will effectively plan for the child and from the child's competencies rather than from what it is you think you want to bring. I think I'm going to show you a little video now, actually, and it's quite short. So I might actually play it twice because it's really, really short. And I just want you to take a little look at the children in this clip. You could make notes on paper, make notes in the chat, or just think in your head about the different children who are sat with me and the different ways in which they're engaging. And then we could maybe just see what people have come up with and see if people have pulled out different things. So
I think we may have lost Kate briefly here.
We've just got something through on the chat from Jenny. She says, this is amazing. Sometimes in settings we are seeing is some song groups with the focus being more about compliance to sit than enjoy the music or song opportunities. So that's really important. Owl is a perfect message. Thank you, Jenny.
Shall I just come in and follow up on that to fill in the time, actually? Yes, I think this compliance to join in is something to really be cautious about, because children, as we all know, are in, you know, engaging in their own way. And you have to rely on your intuition with knowing your children, that not to force things, because to turn people off that sort of creative experiences isn't what we want at all. And to sort of force people to sit when that's not what they want, or to join in, is they're joining in. Children are joining in. Music is a dynamic thing. It's noisy. It's everywhere in a setting. You can't avoid it. So children will be absorbing it wherever they are and taking that on in their own way. So just really rely on your instincts about your children. Music doesn't have to be different to other free play activities. We just sometimes think it's, when we do music, it's got to be very adult directed and follow a particular format. It really doesn't. So please rely on your knowledge of your children, and they will be engaging in the way that's right for them. You don't need to force any kind of compliance. So thank you, Jenny. That's a brilliant point.
Brilliant. Thank you. Do you want to stop that screen share there for me, Abby? Thank you. Brilliant. Let's see, has anybody said anything in the chat about that one? The children are looking to one another, check in together for the group response. Yeah, nice. little boy moved closer. Nice. Yeah. What did anyone else see or hear? Very attentive. Yeah. Flautist mimicked little one covering mouth in awe. Yeah, just do that automatically. Just mirroring the children all the time. Excited to hear a familiar tune. Small group, not large. Interesting. Yeah, interesting. I was actually just in the provision space that day and they were the children who came out of interest. Leslie Scott, so what was the interpretation of that vocalization? Do you know what? I am going to ask Annie and Libby. Have I got Annie and Libby somewhere?
Yeah, hi, Kate.
Hi. Right, hi. I'm going to ask Annie and Libby to come in. What was the interpretation of that vocalization? What was going on?
The amazement on the children's face.
It's something that they'd never seen before.
Yeah, and we hadn't. I've never seen someone play a flute. A flute before, and I think they're just children in awe. Definitely, look at their reaction. Yeah. Look at them looking at each other and as if to say, you know, wow, what's Kate playing? So it was just, that was one
it
of my
lovely
moments.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, and you would make a note of wow moments for individual children, wouldn't you? And you'd have them up on the wall for the parents. And these clips would get shared with the families via the learning app. Is it Tapestry you use?
Yeah.
So they would see that. And I'm going to call our child L there, and you'll both know who it is. Could you say what she said? Because you'll know her words. What did she say?
Amazing. Wow. Amazing.
Yeah. Wow. Amazing. I love it when she moves her body. She goes, amazing. Wow.
Excitement.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know whether you noticed child F in her little costume there. Did you notice she had a little hand on my knee and she just kept kind of moving in a little bit closer? And I think for her, she quite liked that sort of physical contact, didn't she? Yeah. And child B was like almost like couldn't quite believe it. So
totally engaged.
Yeah, thank you. Do you know what? I think I might actually show another clip, actually, because I think this is really, really valuable, getting to see the work. So Abby, I'm not even going to attempt to go near YouTube. So could you please share the second one? And again, this is just a short little clip, so we might watch it twice. And again, we're just thinking engagement. What are you seeing, what are you hearing for individual children? Thank you. Great, brilliant. So okay, let's have a look. They are really engaging with the process. Absolutely gorgeous. The wee dudes with the chimes and ukulele are really jamming with you, aren't they, Becky? They really are, aren't they? They've got the moves, children mimicking. Yeah they're sort of they sort of rock in the same way. Yeah, Kath, I'm always fascinated by the one who's listening and watching. Yes, listening and watching. That child who you notice who was listening and watching, I actually ended up offering Zooms for the families. And that particular child would come to the Zoom with her mum, and then she would replicate all this stuff at home. I often find that the child who's sitting very quietly might be the one who then might be most likely to then take home and replicate, because it's all just going in. One just handling the star, absolutely. So I tried to offer lots of different levels of engagement. So I started to see engagement everywhere, actually. So holding a star for me, that was just as engaged as child L rocking out on her ukulele. One of them finished the end of the rhyme. Yeah. Let me just see if I missed any comments here. Children all engaged, making music with their own instruments, even small movements with props. Yeah, fantastic. Coordinating two arms playing the glockenspiel. Do you know, fair point, it's not easy when you look at just the dexterity required for two-year-olds to use a couple of beaters. There's quite a lot involved in that, so yeah, that's a really good point there, Chris. I'm gonna ask Annie and Libby, just to maybe just, do you want to just say what do you think was going on there? Because you know these kids better than all of us.
All the children were bouncing off each other. You could see them looking, oh, there's no right way or wrong way to play an instrument. Mm-hmm. They were just doing it, and they were just, you could just see how engaged they were yet again.
Yeah.
Do you think one of the first times that you introduced instruments to them as well, so they were just experimenting with the sounds that they could make and obviously mimicking from you with the song that you played, which was really interesting to see them do.
Yeah. I wonder if this would be a good point to talk about. So I'm almost tempted not to even use my presentation because I think this is just as interesting. But I was going to ask, so Annie, do you mind saying a little bit about child L and your relation to? You don't have to if you don't want to, but...
No, that's absolutely fine. Child L is actually my granddaughter, and she struggled in the music project to share, and then eventually she did, and that was like quite a wow moment for me. It took a long process, but I knew it was coming, and then she did. She started sharing toys, instruments and things like that.
And it was really interesting because I think there was a lot of learning in there for me there as well, Annie, because child L is the one who goes, wow! Wow, amazing. She's just so exuberant and so full of life. But I think it was a really interesting because this project was actually a project that was in response to COVID-19. So I made the application to Youth Music to say, right, these are COVID-19 babies. We don't know what we're going to do, but we want to engage the music and movement and try and support them and support the families. And it was really interesting talking to you, Annie, about what her experience had been like and just how she'd just been kind of stuck at home and had never had to share ever. So suddenly coming into setting with all these other two-year-olds, it was actually a physical impossibility. And the turquoise, the light blue ukulele that you saw her with, do you remember? Annie had to go and buy her one. Annie had to just go and buy her one. She thought it was hers. She truly believed it was hers. And I had a moment as a music practitioner where I had to decide. I remember writing down on one of my reflective practice things, I either need to stop working with ukuleles or buy more. So I just chose to buy more. So I now have like 6 ukuleles, and we would do small group work, and I would literally just hand it to and then I would just wait until she was ready to give it back. But it was, what was amazing was that from that inability, genuine, because that's the thing as well, I think everyone in this room, we might have varying degrees of experience with two-year-olds, the struggle to share is real. And I now, as a practitioner, try to avoid asking two-year-olds to share unless it is absolutely necessary. Ask yourself as a practitioner, why do they need to share? What's the importance of the sharing? Because sometimes sharing completely undermines anything you're trying to do anyway. So for trying to take that ukulele away from her caused so much distress that we all reflected on that afterwards and went, whoa, what just happened there? No, we're not doing that again. Like literally having to wrestle a ukulele out of a child's hand. We're just like, no, we're not doing that. We're either not going to bring that ukulele in or there's one for everybody. And I just think that was a really key bit of learning for me. But then as time went on, I think what was really interesting was that those skills of sharing, this project actually really supported that, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. Yeah. Massively.
Yeah.
But couldn't speak when she started in January. Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I can hardly believe that. That's incredible, isn't it? That is really incredible. Well, do you know what? I mean, I haven't even barely touched my presentation. What I might just do is I might just hear from the head teacher. So John Croft is the head teacher at Sir James Knott Nursery School, and I've worked with him for years and years and years. He used to work in children's centres as an early years educator, and we work really, really well together. So it's the connection with John that enabled this project to happen. He's a really busy head teacher. So we decided to pre-record his section because, as we all know, the buck stops with him. And if anything happens in the building today, he's got to sort it out. So just have a little listen to him talking about open-ended working and reflective practice.
I think as we embarked on the project, I really struggled at the beginning. Not that I'm about control, but it was open-ended to the point that we were sort of reflecting, and from those practitioner sort of discussions on a daily, hourly, minute basis really shaped the project. So I think as a leader, you normally know about the process of something and where that's going to lead to. I think with this project, the success of it was that we didn't actually know where it was going to lead. It was we were sort of experimenting around the impact of COVID, but sort of being reactive and responsive along our journey. And it took a good few weeks to think, do you know what, you need to just trust the process. So having reflective time, speaking with the professionals, speaking with the practitioners, that it felt better.
And what would you say are the benefits to taking that time for reflective practice? Why do it?
I think it enables practitioners to step outside of being in the here and now and being in the presence of the children, and to being able to be really honest and frank around you. Do you know that particular activity we did with those particular musical instruments didn't really give the desired outcome that I thought it was going to? What did you think? Oh, well, in my group, they really responded to X. Oh, really? I didn't use X, I used Y. And I think because in an educational establishment, you're just on a continuum all of the time. I think by being able to step outside of that and really reflect on what it is that you're doing, and reflecting back to what is it that these group of children need, but being able to share that within a group sort of situation, I think it would be great CPD for the staff and also for the professionals and the specialists that are involved in the project as well, because I think they learn just as much from the practitioners as the practitioners do from the specialists.
Brilliant. Great. Okay, so for this next little section, I'm going to hand over to Gwyneth Lamb, who is just going to talk us through a little bit about what we learned in terms of evaluating the project. And actually, we really are just one big team, really. So it is just kind of one big team presentation, really. You'll see there's lots of overlap between the things that Gwyneth is reflecting on, very similar to the things that Jess has been reflecting on and myself. So I shall hand over to Gwyneth. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate. Well, hello, everybody. Lovely to meet you all and to be here. Abby is going to look after my slides today. So, Abby, could you just set us off with the first slide? Thank you. So, as Kate mentioned when she was introducing me at the beginning, my role as evaluator had a number of facets, shall we say. So, thinking about today, I thought probably the most useful thing I could do would be, again, to share some of what we've learned, and to share what we found it takes to make engagement happen. And this actually is where I want to start, because when I was thinking about today, this came into my mind. And it's actually a 14th century text by an unknown mystical English writer, which might seem a strange place to start. But the reason I thought of it was its central message is that we only achieve real knowing, in-depth knowing, by letting go of what we think we know. And that's something that we've really recognized on this project, the importance of letting go of preconceptions of what you think you know, of jumping in there with what you think you might work, and taking time to be in this space of unknowing, being there with open eyes, an open mind, keeping that beginner's mindset so that you can really see what is going on, what the situation really is, what the children really are responding, because only then can your practice really meet their needs. Next slide, please. The next thing I wanted to say was you also really learned how important it is to take time over this. Both Kate and Jess have referred to this familiarization period, which was, I think, about 4 weeks, maybe even longer, at the beginning of the project, where Kate was there, but she wasn't being a musician. She wasn't performing. She wasn't doing activities. She was there getting to know the place, getting to get the sense of the feel of the day, the shape of the week, getting to know the children, getting to know the staff. And that has been absolutely invaluable in getting that project off to the right start. And this place of unknowing is something that we've come back to several times, saying, well, we thought we knew, but we need to just think again, did we really know? And I go back to my mystical text, because one of the other things that author said was that it's not an easy place to be. It's a place that takes patience, and it's a place that takes courage. And I think it's true too, as a musician going into a setting, it takes quite a bit to hold back and not prove your credentials, not do the music that you are there and people are wanting you to do because you're the musician. So if you can have the patience and the courage to take your time and really get to know the context in which you're working, it will duplicate, if not more, the impact that you're going to have. Next slide, please. And what it also allowed you to do is start to build those relationships with the staff team. And those relationships have been what has underpinned this project and made it the success, given it its success. And those are equal, respectful, reciprocal professional relationships where both sides, the early years practitioner and the music practitioner, recognize their particular areas of expertise and start to be able to work together, draw on those and start to reflect and plan together. Next slide, please. And we heard John talk about the importance of reflection. And one of the things we have learned is how important it is to resource that reflection. And what I mean by that is John was talking about, you know, reflection on a daily, weekly, almost hourly basis. And yes, the bits of reflection and planning you can do between the staff and the musician while you're in the setting, while the children are there, while things are going on, that's brilliant because it's in the moment. Let's try that. Oh, I think that for that child at this moment, this might work. But you need longer term reflection as well. And if you've got a staff team who say, yes, we'll make time in our staff meetings because we're really committed to this, that's great. But an earlier setting is quite a busy place. There's a lot going on. And it doesn't add to the overall amount of time the staff have for reflection. You're actually cutting into their time that they already have. You're asking them to take something on that's new and different. And if they're going to do that, it really needs to be resourced. As John put it, said to me once, we need to be able to carve out time and space. And we've realized the only way to do that, or the best way to do that, is to actually have that resource, to have funding, which can allow a head teacher to bring in cover so the staff who are directly engaged can come out of the provision, can actually take time out to reflect together and with the musician without and let go for a moment of the daily demands. So this is the next thing I wanted to say, how important it is to not be afraid to ask. What do I mean by that? Well, an early year setting, as we all know, is so busy. A musician going in can sometimes feel, well, I know what I'm bringing is valuable. I know the staff team do appreciate it, but am I asking too much here? Am I asking for some time here, for some space there, for a bit of resource there? But if you've developed those relationships and particularly have that reflection time, you don't need to be afraid to ask because you will know that the early years practitioners understand why you're asking, or if they don't, they'll say, well, I don't understand, explain. And on the other way around, too, on the other side, that the early years practitioners feel that they can ask the musician, why are you doing that? I don't understand. Or could you do this? I think it might be a good idea. So don't be afraid to ask. And sometimes the answer will be, yeah, that's a great idea, let's do that. Sometimes the answer will be, no, we can't because. And that can be very disappointing. It can be worrying because maybe it's something you wrote into your funding bid and you're supposed to do it and you're worried about what funders will say when you say, well, I know we said we were going to do this, but in the end we didn't do it. But I take us back to that idea of getting to know a place properly, recognizing the reality, not the reality they thought you were going to encounter when you wrote that bid 18 months ago, and the need to be realistic and to work with what is. Because if you carry on with your plans regardless, what you're doing won't be appropriate. It won't meet the needs of those children and that setting as it is on the day that you are there. So that means being infinitely adaptable and flexible. One of the most useful things anyone ever said to me was, if you have a plan, you can change it. And I think in this context, I would add on to the bottom of that, and you're probably going to. It means being able to turn on sixpence, going in through the doors, recognizing that what you'd planned for the day just isn't going to work today. Maybe the child you're going to focus on isn't there. Maybe something else is happening. maybe the space you wanted to use isn't available for a very good reason. Turn on a sixpence, come up with something new. It means it takes confidence, it takes skill. It also means having a repertoire of activities that you can draw on at the drop of a hat. Next slide, please. So if you can do all that, what will the result be? Right, this is, I think, what you would achieve. You'd be meeting the children's needs because you would have taken the time to really recognise what those are, to recognise what their engagement looks like, to recognise when they're interested, when they're not interested. Everyone involved would be engaged and invested because the staff you were working with would also have been planning, would have been feeding back to you and reflecting with you. You would have developed practice appropriate to a very particular setting, a very particular context, and modelling that. And so that's more likely to become embedded. Early years practitioners are more likely to pick up and follow what you have been doing. You'll leave more of a legacy. And you as a music practitioner will be constantly growing and developing. Next, please. Excuse me. Next is a mouthful of water. Where would that leave you at the end? Here we are at the end of Music Moves. Do we now know everything? Have we achieved enlightenment? Well, of course not, because every setting, in fact, every child is different. And we're moving on. Our next project is called Music Moves On. And again, it starts with a familiarisation stage where Kate will be going in with a cloud of unknowing, with the open eyes, really getting to understand the setting. And I wanted to leave you with this. This is my favourite thing ever that I've ever seen in the Durham Lumiere Festival. It's called Cloud. It's by artists Caitlin Brown and Wayne Garnett. And when I walked towards this, I saw this cloud shape glowing and shimmering in the distance. And when I got there, there were people under it and I joined them. And what you see is lines there are actually pull cords because it's made up of about 6,000 light bulbs and people go and switch them on and off. And I think this is a lovely illustration of what Jess referred to as interthinking, of how we reflect and learn, because learning takes place in our heads, but we do it together. And we all together light up each other's light bulbs and light up our cloud of unknowing. So thank you. I'm really enjoying today. I hope you are too. And I've just been lots more stuff that I'm looking forward to seeing.
Oh, wow. Thank you, Gwyneth. That was absolutely fabulous. Thank you. I could just see all the nodding. You just see everybody nodding and the chat was lighting up. So thank you so much. That was wonderful. Really well presented. Thank you so much. Kind of a bit of a natural progression on from that. I'm going to just hand over just for 5 minutes to the funder, because none of this work would be possible without funding. And I'm really proud that my funder is Youth Music. And I honestly feel like it's one of the biggest gifts of my career that Youth Music exists, because just everything about the way Youth Music works really chimes with my ethos. And I know that my work is really valued. The fact that we work, this is a project we put in an application for with no required outcomes. That's such a gift as a practitioner. The outcome on this project was the learning of our workforce. It was workforce development. It was what can we learn? We didn't have to tick a single box for a single child. We didn't have to prove or evidence anything for a child. And that just gave us so much freedom. So I'm going to hand over to Zoe Kilp from Youth Music, just to put it in a little bit of context for us within the Youth Music framework.
Hi, thanks, Kate. That was just lots of amazing presentations. And I think, what Gwyneth summed it up so beautifully. And now I'm going to, be the slightly boring funder. Just going to tell, because obviously we're not the most important people. It's quite a privilege to be working for an organisation that's able to support and enable, people to do this work. I'm just going to share my screen. I just want to talk a little bit about who Youth Music is and what we fund. So I'm Zoe, I'm Head of Grants at Youth Music. I'm just going to very briefly talk about Youth Music and what we fund and what we're looking for. So at Youth Music, we're a national charity and we believe that every young person should have the chance to change their life through music. But we know that many don't get the opportunity to do that because of where they are, where they live, what they're going through, things out of their control. So we sort of use insights, influence, and importantly, our investment in organisations and also directly to young people to support more young people aged naught, so from babies up to 25-year-olds, to support them to make, learn and earn in music. And so we're, like I said, as a national charity, we're funded thanks to the National Lottery via Arts Council England, also Players of the People's Postcode Lottery, and support from various other partners, fundraisers and donors. And so importantly, so we fund a broad range of work, but we fund early years work and we want to fund more of it. And what we're looking to fund with early years work is work for children aged 0 to 5, particularly those facing barriers to accessing music making because of their circumstances. And in particular, we look to support work that gives access to quality creative musical experiences. We're also interested in stuff that supports shared learning between early years practitioners, music practitioners and parents and families, so that, you know, that whole ecosystem becomes skilled and confident and engaged in encouraging young children's musicality. And we're also interested in stuff that supports the workforce, in particular sort of diversifying the workforce, the range of people who are working with young children. So that's the sort of work we're looking to support. We're not looking to fund people who tick all of that stuff, you know, one of those things is probably enough, but or a couple of those things. And like I've put up on the slide, we've got a couple of funds. We've got various funds open, but these two funds, the Trailblazer Fund and Catalyzer Fund, are probably the ones that are most relevant if you're looking to get some funding for some early years work. And basically we have Trailblazer Fund, which is for grants of up to £30,000. That's for organisations who want to trial work for the first time, test a new way of working or disrupt the status quo. It's also a fund that very new organisations can apply for, as long as you're constituted and set up legally on the deadline of the fund, you can apply. So it's quite exciting that we're able to support quite new stuff through that. And we've got two deadlines coming up, 24th of February, 23rd of June. So one, you fill in an application form, you find out within 3 months if you're successful. Then we've got our Catalyzer Fund. These are bigger grants. They're grants of up to £300,000. The majority that we give out are around £100,000. They're for sort of longer term projects. They're for organisations who want to sustain work, scale up delivery or create change in sector practice. And so we're sort of looking at sort of more experienced organisations, so organisations who have a track record in this sort of work. And as it's more money, it's a more involved process. This next deadline is the 26th of May. It's a two-stage process because we need to ask more information. And that whole process takes around 5 months. So we've got Trailblazer for that kind of new getting going with something, trying out, testing new things, and then, you know, Catalyzer, where sort of slightly more experienced organisations who want to sort of sustain that work or get it going over a bigger scale. Currently, just generally in our funding, we want to see more applications from the Northeast. That's the sort of region where we're seeing fewer applications from across our whole portfolio. And we're also always keen to encourage more applications for early years projects. We've sort of had less of those in recent times. I always give a health warning as a funder with that. Yes, we're looking for projects from the Northeast and early years projects, but it's still competitive. So I don't want people to sort of take away from that. They sort of guaranteed success, and still, we get a lot of applications. Then I've listed a couple of sort of key resources. So if you go to our website, there's lots of guidance, a specific guidance about our funds. There's lots of supporting resources. We've got FAQs there. You can find out who we funded in the past, so you can see the types of organisations and projects that have been successful. We also publish the success rate, so you can see previously, how many applications we've had and how many we've been able to fund, which I think is just important to sort of, be realistic about how competitive things are and what you choosing what you want to spend your time on. I'd really encourage everyone to sign up to our network newsletter. There's lots of updates on our funding, but also shares stuff from across the sector, blogs, jobs, events, workshops. We also have an exchanging notes programme, which are free online workshops and seminars, and they're available to anyone. You don't just have to be, not just people who are funded by us. In the past, we've had stuff on safeguarding, EYFS, accessibility, fundraising. And if you're signed up to that newsletter, you'll get all the updates about that. And then finally, I just say that the most important thing, which I think is particularly keen to point out, if you've not applied to Youth Music before, is you can contact us before you apply. We really like talking to people. So if you've got a question, and whether it's just like, I'm just not sure if this is the sort of thing Youth Music would fund, or I've been reading your guidance or looked at your application form and I just don't understand what you're asking, you know, please just drop us an email or you can give us a phone call, and we're always happy to talk through whatever stage you're at. You don't have to have a fully formed idea. You know, we're really friendly, and we just want to help people and support you. I've put my email on the screen as well. I'm always very happy to talk to people about any funding, but also in particular early years stuff. That's my particular thing that I enjoy. Thanks very much. Hope to hear from some of you. I'll stop sharing.
Thank you, Zoe. That's really ace. I really appreciate that. And just to reiterate, she means that when she says that, Zoe, because I've taken her up on that. And they're a really lovely organisation to work with. And whenever I'm making an application, I usually put in a call to Zoe and just have a chat through before I ever put any pen to paper or anything. I'm thinking about doing this, what do you think? And, you know, Zoe's been really supportive of my work, and it's really supporting me to grow and develop my business. So thank you very, very much. Somebody asked, is York in the northeast?
No, not in our regions. But
okay,
but
that's yes, a question that still, came in still, on the chat.
But we're still interested. Yeah, still get in touch.
Don't not apply just because, you know, just because northeast is a priority area. But that's not to say that if you're not in the northeast, you shouldn't still apply. Yeah. Early years also is an area where youth music are seeing less applications. So I do think, although, of course, no promises can be made, it does mean you've got a better chance because they are looking for early years applications. So thank you. Fantastic. Great. Okay, time is rattling on. So the next person I'm going to hand over to is Leslie Forrester, who is an absolute, she's a legend. She's a legend in North Tyneside. Anytime you go into a children's centre with Leslie Forrester, everybody knows Leslie. She's been working as a speech and language therapist for years and years and years. She really knows her stuff. But why Leslie and I work so well together is because she naturally brings music into everything that she does. And actually, I learned so much when I work with Leslie, and a lot of the children I work with, especially right now, have massive speech and language difficulties and are needing extra support. And so Leslie sort of comes in as an extra resource, and the teams that I take Leslie to are always so grateful and thankful that they're getting a bit more Leslie. So you're getting a little bit of a legend here in your midst, and she's just going, yes, Leslie, yes. And she's just going to tell us a little bit about her element of the project, which for this particular project was actually just, it was like a little 6-week block. But as we go forward, I think we're thinking we might grow and develop it so that it's more. Thanks, Leslie.
Thank you so much, Kate. What a build up. That's amazing. Thank you so much. I will try and screen share at this point, then we'll see what happens. There it is. So as Kate says, I'm a speech and language therapist. I'm an animal assisted speech and language therapist. And a few years ago, brought animals into my practice and began NATA, which stands for Northern Animal Assisted Therapies and Activities. So I work with my team of therapy hens and with my golden retrievers, Heidi and Gunther, and other small furries. And initially probably went out there to support children's communication development through animal assisted therapy. That was at the outset of COVID. So at that point, I had no idea that rather than individual speech therapy sessions, we'd be spending much more time responding to some of the issues that have been exacerbated by COVID, really. Although what we've been delivering with Music Moves has been animal assisted activities, it's still seated on these principles of animal assisted therapy, which are not well known. It's kind of something that's a little bit niche. So I thought it might be helpful for those who are thinking, why on earth were there chickens involved in this project? Just to run through the kind of the basis for our involvement and why I was so excited to be involved in this. So animal assisted therapy is based on following the initiatives of all of the participants. So that's the animals and the children and the 2-year-olds and practitioners in this instance. But we like our animals to be off leash. We definitely like our children to be off leash. And always with the option of saying no, thank you very much. And we did at times have to say no, thank you. Or Heidi, the therapy dog, said no, thank you. For example, on a really hot day, I don't know if anyone remembers the heat wave. It feels like so long ago now, doesn't it? we were absolutely melting. And there were times where the animals couldn't be present because it was just too hot for them to sort of to engage. So it's all about choice and it's all about freedom. It's definitely about fun and playfulness and really thinking about that, that definition of play as being volitional, you know, engagement on your own terms in a way that feels natural and enjoyable to you. And that applies equally for children and for animals. And animal assisted therapy is founded on the development of positive relationships. So it is about developing empathy. It's why it lends itself so well to supporting children's communication skills and social and emotional development. So that's a little bit about the background in animal assisted therapy. And we were delivering animal assisted activities based on those same principles. And this is Heidi, our therapy dog. She's 3 years old. She's a golden retriever. She is trained to come in and kind of do tricks, and the children can teach her things and train. But mostly she just joins in and the children just join in with her. And I sort of sit in the middle in between them and try and facilitate activities that draw on the things that both enjoy. So the reason why animal assisted therapy is thought to be so powerful is that it's based on this philosophy, this science called biophilia, which is it's a term that describes our own love of other living things, our fascination and affinity with other life forms. And it's not just human beings who experience biophilia. Other animals also have curiosity. And of course, dogs are domesticated and are so important in our lives because they are a social species who is interested in other species outside of themselves. And they're so drawn to these relationships and these engagements with people. So they are man's best friend. And Heidi is certainly a two-year-old's best friend. She's very at home. She's very at ease. Lots of dogs are now in practice in schools. Lots of dogs are school dogs or coming on board as therapy dogs. I just like you to use any opportunity to point out that therapy dogs are raised and prepared very specifically for their role within schools. It isn't kind of a just bring your dog to work day sort of a situation. So Heidi's been reared with this in mind and was selected with this role in mind so that she can participate on her own terms and I can read her body language and keep everybody safe in these situations. So she is used to lots of singing, and because as Kate said, that is another key tool that I use to support communication development for reasons that I could spend a whole day talking about. Music is absolutely top of my list of tools for enriching the communication environment and supporting the next step in every child's communication development journey. So Heidi's accustomed to all of that. She got accustomed to some new things during this experience, flutes, for example. She hadn't encountered a flute before, but Heidi has been reared to expect the unexpected, and she's desensitized to a wide range of interesting new stimuli. So she took that in a stride, and I think she alerted to it and, dare I say, enjoyed it. She was certainly curious about the sound of the flute. It was really interesting seeing her response, just as it was seeing the children's response. So this is how animal assisted therapy works on this science called biophilia, which draws people in where animals are involved. And the presence of the animal itself sort of engenders a safe and warm environment, because animals do have friendly, well-socialized animals do generally have positive regard for people, regardless of how old you are, how many legs you've got, what, you know, how you present, and certainly regardless of what communication skills you have, because these animals are non-verbal to a large extent, although Heidi does respond to quite a wide vocabulary and also some Makaton signs. But they're really interested in all the different ways that people communicate. They respond to body language. And I just wanted to have a moment to say, why on earth bring animals into a music project? Not only are they both very powerful tools to engage and support children's development, but there are some really unique parallels, I think. Some of the underlying mechanisms that make animal-assisted therapy work are also the reasons why I believe music is so powerful in this arena. The first thing I noticed in the chat as we were looking at the videos that Kate shared early on was the children's great attention. So two things that are assured to get everybody turning and looking and listening and engaging. One is the sound of an instrument, or perhaps the sound of a voice used as an instrument, because you know we know that children's brains respond really well to pattern and intonation and to that interest in sort of the melodic aspect of music. They also are sure to turn and look when someone walks into the room with a furry chicken. This is Scylla Black, you can see here on the screen. Scylla is a Pekin. She's a silky. We mostly work with bantam hens, small size hens, silkies and Pekins. So Scylla Black looks a bit like a cross between a chicken and a teddy bear. She's furry, which is interesting to the children. She's got a nice sort of sensory appeal. She's nice to touch, soft to touch, and she has a lovely big, a great big hairstyle, a great big pom-pom on her head. And here she is enjoying a tea party with some of the two-year-olds on the project while we sing songs, and the children are obviously quite engaged, enthralled. In common with music, animals are great for brain chemicals. They're great for feeling good, joining in together and feeling good. And as we boost happy brain chemicals, we're also suppressing stress chemicals. So here we have a much better balance of brain chemistry when we have animals in the room. And then to top it off, if you start singing about them, I think you have a combined, huge potential for this combined effect, a double whammy. And another thing that we've kind of touched on already, there's no pressure where the animals are involved to use language. There are lots of different ways to communicate, much as in when sharing music, there are many different ways to communicate through music and many different ways to participate that don't necessarily involve words. So I think lowering the communication pressure and valuing all of the different ways that children can participate is really important. The hens don't mind whether you're singing the right words. The hens don't mind whether you can talk or not. They just are reliant on you using gentle behaviours, positive behaviours, and they will therefore engage when you show those behaviours. And Heidi doesn't need any words at all. She's happy to respond to signs and other cues, and she's always sensitive to mood. And she's adapting her behaviour according to the way that the children present. And I like this picture and the next photograph because I think they also illustrate an important parallel in animal-assisted therapy and in music. Both of them have this power to provide the oil in social situations. We call them social lubricants. They encourage us to join in together, to participate as a group, to notice one another as a group. And when animals are present, we tend to not worry about how the world is perceiving us. I imagine it's the same kind of implications with music. We're focused on something outside of ourselves. We're no longer preoccupied with how we're being perceived by others. And therefore, it's much easier for us to actually participate as a group, to trust one another. Any of you out there who are dog walkers know that we're much more likely to chat to one another when we have a dog on the other end of the leash than if we were walking alone. We tend to view one another with a little more cynicism or a little more suspicion than when there are animals involved. I think the children see us being kind and gentle with the animals, and they therefore draw conclusions about the adults who are looking after them that they must be kind adults because we're showing that caregiving behaviour to the animals as well. So I was just really excited about this opportunity. I saw these four great energies coming together. We've got the little human animals, the two-year-old human animals. We've got the music. And we've got those non-human animals together with the energy provided by some really up for it, sometimes slightly potty, but really creative, sympathetic people who all had this common goal in mind. We wanted to give these children a really great time and allow the children and the animals to shape the delivery of activities. So as Kate said, we go in with a plan every week and then do something entirely different. I think Humpty Dumpty theme was a case in point. We decided we're going to Heidi likes to knock things down and demolish things, so we're going to build a wall of sponges, and Humpty Dumpty was a little ball that sat on the top. Nope, you couldn't build a wall of sponges and get Heidi to knock it down because the two-year-olds had already rampaged through it and wanted to just throw Humpty around for Heidi to follow. So we could go in with the best of intentions and it would be something different. And my reflections were as follows, just that we had huge shared attention, huge shared enjoyment, that often the flute would just start up behind me because I was singing a song, and that would really support that engagement and that enjoyment. We'd be hooked in by the sound of an instrument that sort of gelled us all together, and we could sing about the animals. Of course, they provided lots of inspiration for creating songs that described the way that the children were interacting with the animals, and that music became a shared language that could then sometimes the musical activities or games could be an underpinning activity that would help support the interactions. Things like peekaboo with voils, which is a game that Heidi already enjoys a lot. We could sing as we played peekaboo games. And as adults, we could use music and write about important behaviours that the children were practising, so we could reinforce all these friendship behaviours that are so hard for children who've been sort of trapped in this situation during COVID, not able to exercise their social skills and develop their confidence with their peers. Music was used. One of the big challenges is bringing a child into a room where there are two-year-olds who, I absolutely agree, Kate, should not be expected to take turns, certainly not in the most motivating of situations. Bring in a big golden retriever and then tell them all to stand back and wait and take turns. Impossible. Really difficult. So small groups worked for Heidi as well as it worked for the children. And we could sing about that. We could say, one by one and turn by turn, helps us listen, helps us learn. Give her space to move and play, and Heidi might play some games today, or whatever. We could reinforce some of those behaviours that we were asking through songs, and that was much more likely to hit home with the children. So we have a little video clip here, if we've got time for it, do we? Give me a nod or a... I'm doing it. Is it on?
Quiet and gentle, soft and slow, treat me kindly so I know you don't mean to frighten me, and I might sit upon your knee.
Oh, stop, stop. I shall stop that. So that was a really quick whistle stop tour about why I valued our involvement so much. And certainly I did learn a lot, and those reflections were really powerful for me. And more I was assured of I don't even know what the word is, when you layer effects on top of one another. I saw that kind of coagulated effect of having the music and the movement and the animals in one space. And found that really empowering. I would have loved to have chickens on the call today, but Virgin Media has chosen today to drop out altogether. So my neighbours have hosted me this morning. So this is Bruce, who
Les. Hello. I am so sorry, Leslie, but I think I might have to cut you off.
Cut me off.
I'm so sorry, because I know you're about to do something brilliant, and I saw you working with that puppet with the children. It was great, but I'm afraid we're going to have to leave it there. Sorry, Leslie, we're going to have to leave it there. Thank you so much. That was absolutely wonderful. And I'm sure Leslie's very happy for anybody to get in touch with her. Her website is just N-A-A-T-A. You Google it, it's just the first thing that comes up. So I'm sure she's very happy for any of you to get in touch with any questions. But I'm afraid we've just got to keep the time. So thank you very much. What I'd like to do now is just hear from John Croft, the head teacher, one more time. One thing we haven't really touched on yet is family engagement, which was a really big part of the project. And actually all of my early years projects involve families. I really believe that the parent, carer, adult, whoever looks after the child should be valued, should be respected as the child's first educator, that we should leave our judgments at the door and work in partnership with them. So just take a little look and we'll hear what John has to say about that. Thanks, Abby.
Everybody, my name is John Croft. I am the head teacher in Senko at Sir James Knott Nursery School in Tynemouth. As we planned for this music project, we felt it was really integral of the project that we had parents and valued the parents of the child's first educator So we decided to do 3 Saturday events, and it was within the summer months. So we were able to do a lot of the work outdoors. And I think myself and practitioners included, we felt that we really got to know our families in a really clear way, sort of the impact that COVID had had on them as a family unit, or with them with regards to being made redundant or having to find other ways of working, and how their children hadn't socialised in any particular groups, their sort of concerns around their child's integration or speech and language. So it enabled us to be able to signpost to relevant organisations and professionals. And it was really powerful on the day. A lot of parents came, not just one, both came, which was really nice to see in that different perspective. And I think for me as well, it was around the importance of everyone's got some form of musicality happening within home. It just looked very different. For example, we got to know that there was a whole range of different genres of music that children and families listened to, that there was particular parents that played instruments that we weren't aware of. Since then, we've had some parents introduce different bits with the musical instruments and things, and the children have really, really enjoyed that. But I think the parents really appreciated and felt part of the project with us because they went on that process with us as well. I think because we were really focusing with the 2-year-olds, that they hadn't had the parents at any sort of events within school prior to that. Some of them felt very proud to show them how they could shake the maracas or get on the bongo drum. I thought what was really key as well is that there were particular parents, and we've got a range of children with additional needs as well. And there was one parent at one of the sessions when we were in the 2-year-old provision, playing and exploring with the different musical instruments. There was one particular child that was going around the room, and the mum got a bit anxious with regards to that, and all of us said, that's absolutely fine. This is what he would do as part of the session. And that was, the children accepted it, the adults accepted it, and I think it really ensured her that it is okay to be like that. And the children all engaged in a way that was meaningful and purposeful to them as well. And since doing the stay and play events and getting that sort of motivation with parents, I'm starting to upload things onto Tapestry now or bringing things in. So it's really seeing that sort of valuing the importance of the parents as the first educator, but also that joined upness between school and home as well. Really, really powerful.
Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that, Abby. Great. So that's kind of one final word from John. We're out of time, which is just like, for me today, it's just gone like that. You know, you could spend a day with Leslie, a day with Gwyneth, a day with Jess, a day with me, and there'd still be more. So, you know, I didn't want it to run over. So I'm sorry if anybody's like, I wanted more. But there's lots and lots and lots there, isn't there? There's lots. And if you do have any burning questions, stay on after the call, or please do get in touch with any of us. I'm really happy to share my email and contact information. Did John say parents as first or third? No, first. He said parents as first educator first. Yeah. Great. So, but I think for today we might leave it there. And I just wanted you to have a think about what from today you might be able to take into your practice. I often find if I come to an event like this, thinking through how it's changed my thinking makes it more likely I will do something as a result of the training, kind of like an affirmation. So, okay. Chat now. All that this was going to say was, I won't, and just have a think from today. I won't. Anything that comes into your mind. Okay. I won't stop reflecting and learning. I won't worry about asking questions. That's a great one. I won't put pressure on the children to sit and always be present during singing circle time. Yes. Let them engage in their own way. Yes. That's amazing. And Becky's really thinking about building in reflective time. It's a huge one. Perhaps me and you could chat about that sometime if you want. It's such a big one, that. Won't talk so much. Yeah, sometimes I just literally have to tell myself to shut up, like literally just sit like that. I won't ask children to share. I won't doubt myself about how I've been thinking or
about how our project can grow, feel more confident. This is all amazing. I won't worry about the children observing from a distance. Yes, amazing, amazing. Okay, one more. I want to learn more things about Nata. Got that, Leslie? Amongst other things, perfect. Leslie did put her email address in here, so she's got a website as well. I want to learn from the children. Yes, Barbara. I want to introduce more musical opportunities for all children within the nursery and explain what we already do. Yeah. I want to learn more about your journaling. Oh, yeah, please do get in touch. I'm prolific. I'm literally prolific. I have files and pads and I do voice notes and all sorts. So, yeah, I want to do a musical stay and play. Yeah, I was worked really, really well. Really, really well. Yeah. Great. Okay. Now, last one. Because I'm aware that it's kind of time. I will. Let's have some affirmations. I will. So we have got, I will be more reflective. Amazing. Yeah, that's been, it's just it's such an incredible thing to take the time. I will observe. Wait, listen, owl. Hooray. Hooray for owl. Owl's transformed my practice. Yes, yes. I will talk to Sorrel about sessions. Great. So is that Jackie and Sorrel, maybe two people who might work together? Great. I will observe more. Yes. I will investigate funding opportunities so that I can reach, yes, reach nurseries, families. Sorry, they're going to, who can't afford a music specialist. Yes. I will look out for different ways of showing engagement. Love the first story you told. Yeah. I will research funding options. Go, Becky. I'm happy to chat about that again. I'll be sharing what I've learned with my team and have time for music even more. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. Isn't that wonderful? I mean, we could stay here and the rest of the day, couldn't we? Literally, I'm just getting going now. This is amazing. But it is just after 1:30. And we do really like to respect your time in case you have somewhere that you've got a boogie to. I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying here. So if you want to stay on, chat, ask questions, that's fine. I'm going to hand over to Charlotte to do the official close, though, because I'm aware some people might just need to boogie. So thanks.
Thank you so much. So yes, on behalf of Culture Bridge Northeast, just want to say a massive thank you to Kate and all of our speakers today. It's been a brilliant workshop. It's been a real privilege to be able to share this work on this platform as well. So I really hope you enjoyed it. And there's loads of takeaways. We're going to be sending emails out with PowerPoints, all the kind of points that we've raised today and all the links and everything. So that'll be coming over to you soon. And our website is best place to find all of our other CPD courses that we have coming up. And our next Let's Play session is on the 7th of March and it's on Eventbrite now. There's still a few places left if you haven't booked a place. Actually, our speaker's here, Jane Parker from Take Art. Hi, Jane. So there's a few places left on that. Please do have a look and book on there. And finally, can I ask you to fill out the feedback form. So you're going to receive that from Sarah today because it's really important to us. Thank you so much. And just thank you so much to everybody for joining in, for all of your insights, and just hope to see you again at one of our upcoming events. Thank you so much, everybody. Have a nice day.